It's Liz here. Thanks for watching this video, it's one of my How to Learn Economics videos. How's your day going, by the way? How are you doing? Is your day being productive? Oh, is my day being productive? Thanks for asking. I guess it really depends what you mean by productivity. And that's what we're gonna be talking about today. What we're doing today is we're gonna interrogate economics terms and really try and see what they really mean. Now, I'm gonna start with a term that seems kind of simple, a word that we all talk about all the time, we all use, work. But what does it actually mean? What do we really consider to be work?
Hey, what am I doing? Bit of the old home economic. I always called it work there, not work, obviously, a bit of cooking. You know, it's obviously not proper work, but I have just spent hours taking flour and water and mushing them together to form a perfect loaf of bread. Oh, you want to see my perfect loaf of bread? I haven't put it in the oven yet. It's, so, you know, probably best not to look quite yet. Oh, you do want to look? Okay, bear in mind this is spelt. This is what spelt is supposed to look like. Just cover it in seeds. Seed is spelt. In she goes.
Nothing, you know, housework. But obviously, housework isn't work, is it? No, I'm not working for my room. Oh, I'm really tired. Yeah, I got up at 5, been looking after this baby thing. And yeah, it's been pretty much non-stop since 5, been on the go all day. But no, not working. Not work in the normal sense of the word. You want to see the baby? Oh, I think probably best not. Just got her off to sleep. Oh, you really wanted to have a little look at the baby? Baby! She is. Right, I'm gonna be totally honest, this is the closest thing I could find to a baby in my flat, and I did not choose for this item to enter my life. A comedian called Mo Omar found it, gave it to me, said if I ever threw it away I'd be cursed, and while I don't entirely believe that, I don't want to throw it away, so thanks Mo Omar. Good babes, I know. It is. He is. Yeah. Babes, yeah. Yeah. The question is writing a 20-page letter to him gonna help you? That's my question. I'm not gonna read the letter, babes. I'll tell you what, if you read my poetry, I'll read your letter. Okay, deal. Love you. All right then, love you, babes. Bye, love you. Doing? Oh, nothing, you know, just doing a bit of research, but it's not for an exam, so it's not work, it's not nothing, is it? Nothing important. Oh, that'll be my mum, no one else calls on my landline. Hi, mum. Yeah, I'm good. Oh, I'm not doing anything, no, not working, nothing important. Sure, I can come round and spend another 4 hours teaching how to use WhatsApp. Sure. Yeah, I did send you a message. Where are notifications? You have to go to the top. That's an emoji. You need your password for that. To turn it on standby. All right then, love you lots, see you later. Love you, bye. Right, I've been looking at this book and this guy, Roger Hutchinson, says that in the 19th century, it was illegal to be a prostitute, although that was one of the main female trades. Up to 500,000, maybe 400,000 women who were working as prostitutes, but as it was illegal, they couldn't record their trades in the census. So he says that many of them call themselves seamstresses. Seamstress. Can't think of a joke for that. But it's interesting, isn't it? Who decides what's legal and what's not legal? And who decides what counts as work and what doesn't? What should be paid and what shouldn't? Who decides what's legal and what's not legal? Who decides what counts as work and what doesn't? What should be paid and what shouldn't? Who made up all these words? So I just want to clarify what I mean here. I'm not having got men, I'm just saying that most of the jobs traditionally done by women, they don't have to be done by women and certainly not always done by women, but they've often been seen as less valuable. So that's like caring jobs, childcare, looking after children, looking after relatives, housework, all of those things have been done typically unpaid. When they have been brought into the marketplace, they've been done on lower wages and often seen as less important than other jobs. Now, that is not to say that men do well in the system. They do not at all for tons of reasons. I mean, let's just look at a couple of things. Firstly, although we don't really talk about this very much, a whole economy is quite underpinned by power relationships and have often been involved in war and conflicts. And men have been on the front line of those conflicts. And that isn't a great place for anyone to be. And secondly, I have seen personally the pressure we put on men. I've seen enough men in my own personal life get ripped apart by this pressure. Like, we can change this. We don't need to have these traditional roles where one person is the breadwinner and has the pressure to earn all the money. Let's end the role of the breadwinner. Let's have more bread bakers.
Oh, hey, how's it going? How did the bread turn out? Oh, absolutely perfect. Amazing. The baking just went really well. Oh, you want to see how it turned out? Do you? No. Oh, you do want to see. Flatbread. This is what I wanted. This is what I wanted. This is exactly what I planned.
So I'm kind of pissing around here, but I hope it's clear why I think it's quite useful to do this, to really interrogate words, economics words that we use in our everyday life, and to consider what we mean by them and what they mean in a formal economics way or a formal contract. And I would really encourage you to do this for loads of different words. You can pick super financially words, like words that would only be in like specific financial contracts. So words like futures, options, derivatives. If you don't know what those all mean in a financial contract sense, you can look them up. But they often have some parallels to how we might use those words in our personal life. But again, they're probably quite different. So that's what I'm asking you to explore. Where they came from, where these words came from, what they mean. And I'd also encourage you to do it, not just for very financial words, but also for words that seem simple, but actually when you start interrogating them, are not at all simple. So growth is a very good one to do. I'd really encourage you to do that. So to compare what you mean by growth in your personal life, or what we mean by growth in nature, and what we mean by growth in an economic sense, the word that we talk about on the news all the time, how the economy is growing and how GDP is growing, gross domestic product. So that's something for you to think about. Another good thing to do, which I might make another video about, is to look at how words have changed their meanings over time. So I do this in my video on unemployment. I look at how the idea of unemployment or work or jobs has changed over time. That's another very good thing to do, very good task to do. Now, depending on what word you've chosen, there's going to be lots of different observations that you might make about it. But I'm going to make one observation, which I think applies to a few of these words, which is that if there's a really big difference between how we might use a word in our personal lives and how it might be used in financial contracts, we might have a problem. So to be a bit more specific, with debt, for example, which I've looked at in another video, there's a really big difference about how we use the word debt in our personal lives and how we might treat debt among friends and family members to how financial institutions and banks treat debt and how they expect debt to be paid back pretty much no matter what. And I think we need to put some more humanity into our financial world. Just to clarify, when I say humanity, I know that humans can be total I mean the caring and compassionate elements of humanity. Put more of that in our financial contracts, not the warring and violent aspects of humanity. There's already quite a lot of that in our financial contracts. So less of that, more of the caring stuff. So there is one observation about this. I could make lots more observations, but then it'll be quite a long video. And I've made quite a few quite long videos already. So let's just keep it short. And one observation, if you do the task, which I don't know if you will genuinely do it, I should say this is part of my economics on lockdown school. And I made quite a few videos. I'll put them in the playlist, which you can watch about how to learn economics. And I'm setting kind of tasks for you to do. I don't know if anyone's doing them or not, but you know, you should do them. Or maybe you shouldn't, who knows? You do whatever you want. You do what you want, it's your time. Anyway, this is basically the end of the video. You're here, so thank you for still being here. I would love to know that you're still here by if you put a little comment in the comment section. If you put a little bread emoji, I'll know you watched it till the end. That's quite a nice thing for me to see. So that'd be nice. I should probably also say, full disclosure, the bread in the background is, you may have guessed, not a loaf that I baked. That is my friend Sam baked that. And I mean, well done, Sam. What a lovely looking loaf. Congratulations, mate. And there's that. We're at the end of the video, so thank you for watching. So I'm really new to making these videos and I'm really actually enjoying making them and learning how to do it. So if you like them and want to encourage me, then like this video, subscribe to the channel, share it, that sort of thing. That really helps keep my motivation up. Although, to be honest, I'm pretty motivated to do it anyway. I've got quite a strong work ethic. If this is work, that's a very good question. Call back to the topic. And I think we're there, aren't we? This is the end of the video. So I think we're going to go now. So I'm going to sign off. Thank you, everybody. Have a good and productive rest of the day. Bye.